hemliga polisen allra innersta. Oleg Gordievskij hade länge varit en dubbelagent, anställd av KGB, men en formidabel läcka till den brittiska säkerhetstjänsten och till amerikanska CIA. Hans dramatiska flykt från Moskva 1985 blev uppmärksammad över hela världen. Själv gick han under jorden och har varit osynlig i 5 år sedan dess. I vintras ställde Oleg Gordievskij för första gången upp inför tv-kamerorna. Det brittiska bolaget BBC fick göra det första porträttet med Gordievskij. I den här intervjun ger en välmaskerad Oleg Gordievskij inte bara en skildring av den sovjetiska säkerhetstjänsten och dess arbetsmetoder. Programmet blir också ett mycket ovanligt porträtt av personen Oleg Gordievskij. Han visar sig vara en man som är rädd för att rodna och därmed avslöja sig i en trängd förhörssituation. En familjefar som förtvivlat fortsätter att hoppas återse sin hustru och sina barn. En människa som kämpar för att få leva ett nytt liv. Kort sagt, en agent så långt från 007 som man bara kan tänka sig.
Ett fotografi av överste Oleg Gordievskij vid den sovjetiska underrättelsetjänsten KGB innan han började arbeta som dubbelagent för brittiska MI6. Oleg Gordievskij är den hittills viktigaste avhopparen från KGB som flytt till England. Det här är den första filmen om mannen som riskerade livet för att spionera för väst. Hemkallad till Moskva på grund av misstankar hos KGB blev han drogad och förhörd. Han lyckades med knapp nöd fly från Sovjetunionen i en vågad räddningsaktion organiserad av MI6. Efter avhoppet till Storbritannien har han hjälpt väst att förstå irrgångarna i Mikhail Gorbatjovs nya radikala politik. Han har personligen konfererat med premiärminister Thatcher och presidenterna Reagan och Bush. Det har varit en lång och svår resa från Moskva.
You don't regard yourself as a traitor at all.
I don't regard myself as a traitor towards the Russian people and the Soviet Union as a group of nations. I'm of course a traitor against the regime of communism, of the communist system and supported by the KGB.
Av säkerhetsskäl har Oleg Gordievskij i 5 år levt under antaget namn och på hemlig ort. Men i februari i år, då förhören med honom om hans spionverksamhet var över, trädde han äntligen fram och gav sin första tv-intervju. Han berättade hur hans mor brukade ifrågasätta det politiska systemet i Sovjetunionen, men hur han ändå hade bestämt sig för att gå med i det som för honom var familjeföretaget, KGB.
My father was in the KGB, though not an operational officer, but just a military KGB teacher. My brother was an intelligence officer. And it was some influence of my father, in particular when my brother joined the KGB. Another reason was that it was fun. At that time I was young and romantic, and my political feelings and my doubts, they were at that time still very low. And the work in the intelligence service, it was thrilling. I hoped it would be something interesting and exciting.
But didn't you have any sense that the KGB you were joining was still the KGB of the gulags, of repression, of purges and so on? Didn't you in the back of your mind feel that at all? Or did you feel it and ignore it?
There was, of course, I must admit, it was a little bit hypocritical attitude. Because I was joining the intelligence, foreign intelligence branch of the KGB, I thought I was distancing myself from the rest of the KGB, which was associated with the purges, with the gulag and so on.
Men det dröjde inte länge förrän verkligheten i Brezhnevs Sovjetunionen hann ifatt Gordievskis blåhet. Sovjetledarens besök i Prag inledde en återgång till Stalintidens gamla brutalitet. När de sovjetiska stridsvagnarna rullade in i den tjeckoslovakiska huvudstaden satte de utan förskoning stopp för Dubčeks reformförsök. Gordievski blev obodligt desillusionerad av det system som han tjänade som underrättelseofficer.
That was a tremendous blow to my to the rest of my belief that the communism was able to evolve. At that time I thought, no, the communism will never change. It is a rigid totalitarian system which I reject. The courageous Czechoslovak people tried to regain freedom and democracy and was stopped by the repressive Soviet regime. From that day I would never again support that regime. I would never again feel myself as a communist. So it was at that day I became, you may call it mental defector, but I would call it rather mental or hidden dissident. A dissident in the heart of KGB.
Gordievski, som 1968 var stationerad i Köpenhamn, förmådde inte helt dölja sin avsky för sitt lands invasion av Tjeckoslovakien. Han ringde ett par oförsiktiga och politiskt frispråkiga samtal till sin hustru från Sovjets ambassad i Köpenhamn. Samtalen bandades och överlämnades till den brittiska underrättelsetjänsten som genast registrerade den unge KGB-officeren som en potentiell avhoppare.
I think the British were very good at knowing the people, studying them. And I found they knew a lot about me. And they knew a lot about other Soviet officials. Actually, I was not recruited immediately afterwards. First, a couple of years later. They were still looking at me, watching me.
MI6 var beredd på att vänta länge, men tidigt en morgon 4 år senare, 1972, när KGB-officeren spelade badminton i Köpenhamn, var även britterna där och spelade.
I was actually found and met in the early morning hours in a badminton club. I was the court was available only between 7 and 8 in the morning where I played. And they have somehow learned about it and staged an accidental encounter with me between 7 and 8 o'clock in the morning in a Danish badminton club.
And you responded immediately?
The fact was that ideologically I had been prepared for it for a long time, but psychologically it was a very important and difficult step to make.
It is a huge decision to become a traitor. You told me earlier that you became a traitor not against the Soviet people, but against the state. But surely the state and the people are as one in these matters.
No, I don't think so. I think I didn't betray the country. I didn't betray the people of the Soviet Union, Russian people and the peoples under the umbrella of the Soviet Union. I think I betrayed the regime and the Soviet communist system, which was illegitimate, wrong, and in many periods of the Soviet history even criminal.
1980 hade Sovjetunionen invaderat Afghanistan, hejdat avspänningspolitiken och kommit med de första köldknäpparna i ett nytt kallt krig mellan öst och väst. Samtidigt som Moskva återgick till militära styrkedemonstrationer av gammal välkänd modell blev Gordievski hemkallad till den sovjetiska huvudstaden och placerad på KGB:s brittiska avdelning. Och 1982 blev han till stor glädje för cheferna på MI6 stationerad i London. I Storbritannien bedrev fredsrörelsen vid denna tid en intensiv kampanj mot utplaceringen av amerikanska robotar. KGB stödde visserligen det här motståndet, men det var ändå bara en bisak för den sovjetiska underrättelsetjänsten.
The main requirement is to the penetration of the government agencies of the political life, not the peaceful and influence. It is a secondary for the KGB, and I can explain why. Because only KGB can penetrate with secret means, with agents, the establishment, while influencing the peace movement, influencing public organizations, spreading propaganda. Many Soviet organizations can do it.
What you're saying is better to have one man in the one member of parliament than eight ladies outside Greenham Common.
Oh, for the KGB it was much more important to have one minor clerk in the Ministry of Defense or in the Foreign Office rather than 100 ladies in Greenham Common, yes.
Did you ever manage to get a minor clerk in the Ministry of Defense or the Foreign Office?
No.
You managed to run one agent, though, didn't you? You yourself had one very important agent.
I ran a few contacts, yes, a couple of agents and a couple of confidential contacts, but not very important, really. It would be an exaggeration to say.
One of them was important.
It is a question of speculation, really.
What's your? Well, you knew him because you were running him. Can you give me any indication of how important he was?
No, I prefer not to speak about personalities.
You obviously can't name him, Oleg, and I wouldn't ask you to do that, but he was a man of some consequence.
No, I can't really speak about personalities. Even I can't, can give you a hint who it was or whom they were.
Has he since been prosecuted?
No, nobody was prosecuted as a result.
Why not, do you think?
I think because there was not enough evidence to be sufficient in court.
To have the case officers to have a great deal of evidence, isn't it?
Identiteten på Gordievskis viktigaste agent i Storbritannien förblir en väl bevarad hemlighet utanför regeringskretsarna. Gordievskis andra kontakt var någon som hade varit i kontakt med Sovjets ambassad och blivit aktivt engagerad i spridning av sovjetisk vilseledande information i parlamentet. Men först redogör Gordievski för inriktningen av KGB:s desinformationsverksamhet i Storbritannien.
The KGB station is supposed to have channels of for active measures, persons, agents, confidential contacts, targets of cultivation, who are prepared to accept some of those ideas or some of those so-called facts about, say, Reagan and his administration, and to write articles in some newspapers or magazines, or speak on the radio, or speak about it in the speech in the parliament, and the person happens to be a member of the parliament.
But Oleg, the journalistic
of active measures.
In the journalistic world in which I live, it would be almost impossible for me to produce some kind of disinformation about Ronald Reagan and get it onto Panorama, or for a reputable newspaper to publish some kind of disinformation. I mean, did you ever have any success in this at all? Can you think of an article that appeared in a serious publication or of a TV program that managed to publish disinformation about Reagan?
In Britain, KGB was not very successful, but I think few pieces in some very insignificant media did appear. So KGB was in the position to report about something.
Did you ever have a man in the House of Commons who would get up
no,
and
I
make
told
a speech?
You that, yes.
No, I'm not going back to an old thing.
Yes.
I'm just asking, did you ever have anybody who could even influence a member of parliament to get up and say something that the KGB wanted him to say? Did you even get as far as that?
Yes, I can tell you that the KGB in London was very interested in the House of Commons and the House of Lords as well, trying to find somebody who would
yes.
become a channel of influence there.
And I'm talking about the difference between desire and achievement here.
Yes, but if we were to speak about the achievements, then we would speak about personalities. And I told you that I'm sorry, but I can't speak about the
All right, but you said that in terms of media coverage there was no great success. Was there any success in the House of Lords or in the House of Commons?
I think yes. There was some success.
You want to tell me about it?
No.
which you managed. Did you then, I'm not trying to pry into any, into too many secrets here, but can you actually say that a piece of disinformation was cooked up in Moscow Center, was sent to you in the residency in London, and finished up being delivered on the floor of the House of Commons or in the House of Lords?
First of all, I don't want to go into the details, who and where in House of Commons and the House of Lords and in another forum.
I'm not asking for you, I'm just saying, did it happen?
But what I'd like to say, that when I said disinformation, it was probably not an entirely accurate description, because the section of the KGB which is responsible for the disinformation mostly sends out to the stations not really disinformation, but arguments and facts slightly doctored.
I understand that, but let me come back to the issue of whether or not you saw something that originated in Moscow actually delivered on the floor of the House of Commons or the House of Lords. Did that ever happen?
Yes, I think yes.
But you're not sure?
It happened some years ago.
So there was a case where it definitely happened?
Probably, yes.
You're not going to tell me, are you?
No, I can't tell you that there's too much so that you be in the position to deduce the names and so on.
Will say it's in the public interest to know who speaks for Moscow in the House of Commons or in the House of Lords.
Okay. Not in the position to continue the discussion.
1985 kom Gorbatjov till makten. Mycket lite känt i väst om den process enligt vilken politbyrån väljer en ny ledare. Men Gordievsky, som nu hade uppnått en hög position inom underrättelsetjänsten, kunde upplysa britterna om KGB:s roll i denna svårbegripliga process.
In 1984 I had a strong feeling that the KGB was helping Mr. Gorbachev. I had a strong feeling that KGB regarded Mr. Gorbachev as the best candidate to become the Soviet leader.
What gave you that feeling?
The feeling was that feeling I received because the briefing KGB was giving to Mr. Gorbachev was very special. It was especially excellent, detailed, profound briefing.
Gordievskys kunskap om Gorbachev växte när den kommande ledaren besökte London. Gordievsky var nu andre man på beskickningen. Thatchers pressmeddelande att Gorbachev var en person som väst kunde göra affärer med var delvis resultatet av en mycket grundlig genomgång med Gordievsky.
You were in the extraordinary position of working for MI6, but at the same time looking after Mr. Gorbachev's interests and briefing him. Did you warn the British that here was a man who was potentially interesting, different to the old guard? What did you say to them about him?
What was I able to confirm to them? That there was a tremendous interest and sympathy in the KGB for Mr. Gorbachev. He was briefed very thoroughly. KGB made a lot of efforts to collect as much information for him as possible. And that he was an able, not a lazy like many of his colleagues, but an able, energetic man who was keen to learn. And particularly, he was keen to learn as much as possible about Great Britain and about Great Britain's achievements.
Michael Bettany, MI5-tjänstemannen som greps 1984 för försök att spionera för Sovjetunionen och dömdes till 23 års fängelse. Gordievsky medger nu att det var han som först tipsade den brittiska underrättelsetjänsten.
Let me ask you about the Bettany affair, which was a far more serious affair. He made an approach to the resident in the London embassy and General Gook, and this was revealed by you to MI6. Weren't you taking a great personal risk when you did that?
Yes, I was. I was taking great risk. And there was probably no choice for me.
Why?
At that time, I was in a way, dedicated supporter of the British and generally Western interests, and a potential spy like Bettany, giving away secrets of a very important Western security service to the KGB. That threat was very high. It was impossible to tolerate. So in a way, I was prepared to take the risk in order to protect the security of Great Britain.
Was it a little tricky at that time, meeting the British?
Because the life of a KGB officer under the cover of the embassy is busy anyway, very busy. It is a tricky business to carry out tasks of a British agent simultaneously. Yes, it was tricky.
Dangerous?
Yes, dangerous, because if I was noticed in doing something illegal, it would mean immediate recall and execution.
What really kept you going? I mean, where did that inner strength come from? I mean, here you are leading a double life. You can't tell your family, you can't tell your colleagues. You are committing treason, which is a serious thing. Where did the strength come from?
You may believe I'm pompous, but the fact is that I firmly believed in the values of the Western civilization, in the importance of the security of the West. I felt that, particularly in the 70s, the Soviet empire, the Soviet military and political might was expanding to a dangerous degree. I saw how one country after another was swallowed by the communist influence. So my inspiration would come from the fact that I thought I was doing something very useful and very important for the preservation of the Western civilization.
Really? I mean...
Yeah, it was really. It was really so. That I was very romantic. Now I know that the Western society is so split and many people don't believe at all in the Western values and are ready to support different tyrannical regimes in the world. I'm now I'm much more sober-minded.
Men vid det här laget var kontraspionageexperterna på underrättelsetjänstens högkvarter i Moskva medvetna om att det måste finnas en förrädare på högsta nivå. Deras analyser visade att de hemliga uppgifter som Gardievsky hade överlämnat till MI6 kunde komma från en officer med just hans bakgrund. Genom en ödets ironi sökte de hjälp hos en annan avhoppare. En brittisk underrättelseofficer som hade flytt till Moskva 1963, Kim Philby, MI6-tjänstemannen som hade spionerat för Ryssland i nästan hela sitt liv. 1979 var han fortfarande aktiv, arbetade fortfarande för KGB och utförde fortfarande ett skickligt arbete.
When Kim Philby had analyzed the papers, he came to the conclusion that the leak was not from the Minister of Foreign Affairs, not from communication, but it was directly from the KGB. At one closed session in my department, the head of the department, addressing a very small audience of about only 7 persons, he told us about the results of Philby's analysis, and he said that the leak could be from that circle, so that very circle, from one of those 7 men present. And of course I knew that I was the source of leaks. And it demanded from me a tremendous self-control and concentration not to reveal myself by body language, by a gesture. And particularly I was afraid of blushing. So I made a tremendous effort to control somehow my nervous system and my skin not to blush.
Men inte ens Gardievskis tur kunde vara hur länge som helst. Och det måste bli även hans tur att föras till KGBs högkvarter utanför Moskva för ett inledande förhör. Sakta men säkert gick KGB igenom alla misstänkta. 1985 lurades Gardievski att återvända till Moskva.
The pretext they used to call me was a series of important meetings with important people. And it never materialized. No meetings, no appointments, no discussions. other small suspicious moments. And then eventually they interrogated me.
Where?
They found a cottage, special KGB cottage outside the compound of that first chief directorate for intelligence. In the beginning there was pretense that it was something, just a neutral discussion about something businesslike. But then they put drugs in my food or drinks.
How do you know?
Because it's immediately my personality was changed. Immediately, profoundly. I lost control over myself, I started talking, my thinking was strange. And it lasted probably something like at least 5 hours. And that, in such a state, I was interrogated by them. And they were trying to extract a confession out of me, or maybe some other details.
What do you think the drug was? Was it pethidrine, the truth drug, the so-called truth drug?
Obviously something in that, of that kind, or related to it.
But how did you feel? Suddenly you found yourself talking uncontrollably. Were you talking the truth? Were you making any admissions?
I don't know exactly what I said. Later, I started to recollect some of the details. But because I was psychologically, had been psychologically prepared for an KGB interrogation for a long time, probably my brain was programmed in a way for such a situation. So even under drugs, I think I didn't reveal anything.
What did they ask you?
They asked numerous questions about my contact with the British, about my cooperation, about details, and I didn't reveal anything.
Can you recall, even in your drug-induced condition, whether they seemed to know anything?
Yes, they knew something, but not enough to start to prosecute me immediately. They were desperately looking for more evidence.
You obviously survived that first interrogation in the cottage. Was there any violence? There was no violence.
No, no. When I probably collapsed in the evening after the interrogation, they left me in peace. Next morning, they brought me home and left it without immediate consequences.
Now, you went back to your flat.
Yeah.
You must have had some very serious thoughts about your future then.
Oh yes, I was very worried. And, 2-3 days later, when I started to recollect the whole content of the interrogation, I realized that I was under strong suspicion, and my life was in great danger.
Under these conditions, you had to make contact. You had to use the failsafe operation with the British.
I only can tell you that I used the available possibilities to organize my escape.
Yes. Let me ask you some questions, which are not going to reveal anything at all, Oleg, because you're too skilled at this business. You had to make contact with the British while you were under surveillance by the KGB. Yes?
What is your next question?
Obviously. Mm-hmm. I mean, the answer is yes, or you wouldn't be sitting here now. Mm-hmm. Yes? Yes.
Other questions.
Well, I want to ask
might be able to answer.
I want to ask you what kind of contact it was. Was it a brush contact? Was it a telephone call?
No, it is absolutely impossible to tell. I can't tell such a thing. All these technicalities, they do belong to the sphere which is extremely important and can be vital for another person who may be in danger.
I understand that the network that got you out is something that you must never under any circumstances reveal. Even I understand that. What I'm asking you to tell me is some of the things that reveal nothing at all. You obviously had to make contact with the British, and the contact was successful, despite the fact that you were under KGB surveillance.
I would rather prefer to speak about what I did. And what
so
I
I'm
did.
Trying to
I started to think about the route. I started to think about the tickets. I started to think about how to get rid of the KGB surveillance. I started to think about how to send to the KGB false signals, where I was going to go, whom I was going to visit, where I was likely to be staying at the next weekend. So I sent plenty of such signals, dispersing the KGB's resources on false targets. And then one evening, when it was time for me to go, I quickly left the building, quickly crossed the lobby of the block where a concierge sat, and practically ran through the across the road and disappeared in the park. And since nobody in Moscow saw me ever.
That's literally how you left home.
Yeah.
Tell me, just before I take the story further, what was the last thing you said to your family? Was that in the flat before you ran out?
The family left Moscow in the second half of June, while I left Moscow in the direction of the border, to cross the border, in the middle of July. So I hadn't seen my family for three last weeks of my stay in Moscow.
Did you know you wouldn't see them again when they went on holiday?
Yes, I did.
You obviously could not let them know that you were going to defect. You, at the same time, you must have tried to say goodbye to them.
Yes, I did. Yes, I tried to say goodbye. I kissed the children, and I kissed the wife and said goodbye. But I was not in the position to tell them more because my wife didn't know about my contact with the British. I didn't want to her to carry that heavy burden of knowledge and responsibility for what I had done. That's why. So I just said goodbye, kissed them, and it was all.
How did you feel?
Very sad, very sad, very sad. I love my family, my children and wife so much that it was a terrible shock for me. It took me, after the escape, more than a year to recover after that, more or less recover. Morally after that shock, but I'm still missing them very much.
There is a chance that one way or the other, under the changed circumstances in Moscow, that your family may either hear a tape of this transmission or even see the videotape. Would you like the opportunity now to say anything to them at all through us? Is there any message you'd like to give to them?
Oh, yes. Of course, I hope that they will see the tape. It's not a very, very great, but my message to them would be the only that I love them very much, and I firmly hope and know that we will be reunited, and I hope that we shall be reunited very soon.
Gardievsky bodde på åttonde våningen i det här bostadsområdet i Moskva. Han hade gjort sig känd som en inbiten joggare, och han gav sig iväg som vanligt i träningsoverall, som om det bara var för den vanliga kvällsrunda. Han sprang ut genom porten till sitt hus och in i parken längre bort. KGB-männen som hade honom under övervakning antog att han skulle komma tillbaka som vanligt. Men den här gången slutade han inte jogga förrän han kom fram till Leningradstationen i Moskva. Dubbelagenten var ute på en lite längre tur. Han hade redan pass och pengar med sig. Därifrån tog han tåget västerut. Slutmålet var Sovjets gräns mot Finland och friheten.
All the time on my way to the in the direction of the border, it was a great chance to be discovered or caught, maybe by mistake even, either by the police or by the KGB. And on my long way to the freedom, it was another encounter with the police and another encounter with the KGB, and there were dogs, KGB dogs and other things.
There must have been, there always is, in the greatest dramatic films, there is the moment when you get to the border, the last checkpoint. Can you describe what that was like?
When I found myself in freedom, in a free Western country at last, I felt that the whole world around me was a different one. It was a world full of colors, of air, fresh air, of happiness. And joy. It was a lovely feeling to be free.
MI6 hade gjort upp en mycket djärv flyktplan för att få ut sin högt värderade agent. Inte ens 1985 var det särskilt lätt att mitt för näsan på KGB föra ut en person ur Sovjetunionen och lyckligt och väl föra honom till rätt sida av gränsen. För Gardievsky innebar det slutet på ett liv som dubbelagent och en rivstart på ett nytt som rådgivare till ledare som nu har börjat att förändra den gamla ordningen. Det var sommaren 1985 och president Reagan visade sig allt mer vänligt stämd mot den nya sovjetledaren. De hade tillsammans kommit överens om att bryta isen vid ett toppmöte i Genève. Men Reagan var i trängande behov av att veta mer om Gorbatjov. Han sa åt sin CIA-chef Bill Casey att flyga till London och fråga ut Gardievsky.
We spent more than 4 hours talking about everything which is relevant in the context of the next of the summit.
What did he want to know?
Many things. He wanted to know what kind of person Gorbachev was and his wife. He wanted to know what the Soviet position was likely to be. On SDI, on Soviet-American relations, on arms reductions and so on. He wanted to get from me a couple of tips about the Soviet mentality, their way of thinking, their traditional paranoia, and what kind of behavior the Americans were likely to expect from Gorbachev and his aides, and so on and so on.
Did he try any potential Reagan tactics for the summit out on you at all?
Yes, for example, he asked me if, okay, I understand, he said that the Soviet position on SDI is likely to be negative, firm, rejecting it. But if we suggest to share the SDI technology with the Soviet Union, I said, no. No chance, not a chance. They will not buy it. The Russians will never believe that the Americans would be prepared to share a very modern, advanced and secret military-related technology with them.
When you watch the television reports of that famous fireside summit and when you received your own information from the British, did you sense that your advice had been followed by President Reagan?
Yes, I did. I understood that my advice was taken by the American team, used very much, and it was successful. I felt even that during the first summit, the American side was more successful than the Gorbachev's team.
Förutom den politiska analys som Gardievsky har kunnat erbjuda, har han också tack vare sin unika bakgrund kunnat hjälpa till att ge svar på många av de gåtor som besvärade den brittiska underrättelsetjänsten under 60- och 70-talen. Var Sir Roger Hollis, MI5-chefen på 60-talet, KGB-agent? Var Graham Mitchell, vicechefen, även han en spion som arbetade för ryssarna? Blev Labour-ledaren Hugh Gaitskell mördad av en av KGBs mordpatruller 1963? Och var det ett mord som den efterföljande premiärministern Harold Wilson, även han förmodad KGB-agent, drog nytta av? För 3 år sedan tog Peter Wright upp de här påståendena i sin kontroversiella bok Spycatcher. Oleg Gardievsky är en av de få personer som säger sig känna till sanningen inifrån. Så här sa han till sina förhörsledare.
Was Sir Roger Hollis the Director General of MI5? Between 1956 and 1965, ever a KGB agent or a KGB asset or an agent of influence?
No, he wasn't. He never was. Absolutely no evidence that he had any contact with the Soviet authorities. And I simply can't understand. I can't understand why again and again the subject of Roger Hollis arises in the British books. Publications. It is a great enigma for me because he was a loyal and distinguished civil servant.
How do you know he couldn't have been a KGB asset or an agent?
You know that for a period of time in 81, 82, I was practically in charge of the British desk. And during the 3 years of my time in London, I was a senior KGB officer. Dealing with Great Britain only. It was not conceivable, really, not to know that there had been such an important agent of KGB.
More than that, if a person like him had been an KGB agent, the people in the first chief directorate would have gossiped, talked about it. There would be some indication in the files, in the textbooks, in the lectures in the KGB schools and so on. But there was no information and no signs of it at all.
Let me ask you the same question about Graham Mitchell, who was the deputy director of MI5 until 1963. Was he in any sense a KGB agent, asset, or agent of influence?
Not at all. Absolutely nothing.
For the same reasons?
For the same reasons.
You heard nothing?
Absolutely nothing. And I think very few people in the KGB knew or know his name.
Was the Labour leader Hugh Gaitskell the victim of a KGB assassination squad?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. It is extremely unlikely.
Why?
After the war, the KGB started to abandon the policy of assassinations abroad. And slowly, also on the political level, there was a feeling that this assassination of a foreign leader is absolutely reprehensible, dangerous, risky, politically wrong and unnecessary.
Was Prime Minister Harold Wilson ever a KGB asset or a KGB agent of influence?
No, he wasn't. There is no foundation at all for those rumors. I actually don't know at all why and who generated those rumors about him. If such a person like a Prime Minister had been a KGB contact, it would be broadly known in the KGB. And he was not even regarded as a target of cultivation by the KGB.
Have you read Peter Wright's book, Spycatcher?
Yes, I have. I've read it.
What did you think of it?
I think there is a lot of fantasy in it, and malicious speculations, and exaggerations and inventions.
What you've just said is that all the agony that the British intelligence services went through in the 60s over Hollis and Mitchell and various other allegations was all a waste of time.
Oh,
it's
yes.
All nonsense.
It was waste of time, waste of resources, waste of paper. All those articles were published. A great damage. And the public morale and the trust to the intelligence security services in the Western countries was impaired. It is a great pity. It was absolutely unnecessary.
Oleg Gordievsky har redan börjat ett nytt liv som skarpsinnig analytiker av den politiska utvecklingen i Östeuropa och i Sovjetunionen. Sitt tidigare liv som spion har han lämnat en gång för alla. För många avhoppare har resan från ett liv till ett annat varit en svår och farofylld färd, kantad av sorg, saknad och anklagelser. Men Oleg Gordievsky, både rysk och brittisk patriot, lever inte längre ett dubbelliv. Han har till och med lyckats med att anta den svåraste utmaningen av alla, att bli en helt vanlig engelsman.
I feel myself quite well integrated in the British society. And in many aspects I'm like a normal British citizen with similar habits and customs. For example, the greatest Sunday pleasure is to spend the morning reading Sunday newspapers, sometimes in bed. And I never expected it from me myself that I developed the interest for gardening. I started to buy shrubs and trees and to plant them and to cut grass and so on.
And when you go to bed at night, Oleg, and you stare at the ceiling, there are no regrets at all?
No, there are no regrets at all about my what I did with my life and how I changed it and how I had to flee and now live in another country. Not at all. The only regret that I was not clever enough to keep my family together, that I was deceived by the KGB, went into a trap. As a result, I escaped, but the family, leaving the family behind. That is what's the only thing which I regret.
I vår serie Spioner, patrioter, förrädare imorgon klockan 22 porträtteras en amerikansk mästerspion, John Anthony Walker Jr., som sålde amerikanska flottans kodsystem.